Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome, and thank you for joining us today for this exciting event, Tech for Social Good, put on in conjunction with the Department of State and their TechWomen program. My name is Sarah Morris, and I'm Policy Counsel for the Open Technology Institute at the New America Foundation. The New America Foundation is a vibrant, policy-focused think tank comprised of a diverse array of programs. Programs that include an assets building program, which houses the Global Assets Project, led by our moderator, Jamie Zimmerman, a Middle East task force that looks to deepen the debate on American policy towards the Middle East, programs on health, education, budget reform, and the Open Technology Institute, which endeavors through technological, policy, and socially driven interventions to promote broadband access and adoption domestically and abroad. The Open Technology Institute's technical work, including its development of a wireless mesh infrastructure called Commotion, has received much press and attention, and we view the technology as an important component to social change here and around the world, particularly where there is great need for connectivity due to government control or resource scarcity. However, we recognize that technology alone is insufficient for social change. People are the critical piece. Their ideas, passions, and desires for widespread change are what makes the technology relevant and important. And that is why we're so thrilled to have you all here. You and your stories are that critical component. So thank you to the Tech Women and to the mentors for joining us today. And for those joining us via the webcast, Tech Women is a 41-woman program of the U.S. Department of State's Bureau of Educational and Cultural Affairs, implemented by the Institute of International Education, that connects female technology leaders in the Middle East and North Africa with their peers in the United States. By facilitating knowledge exchange and cross-cultural dialogue, the program encourages women across the globe to harness the power of technology to foster social change and innovation. I also want to thank our panelists, Patty, Adarsh, and Alex, and to Jamie Zimmerman for serving as our moderator. Also, a big thanks to the State Department, and in particular, Suzanne Fillion and Heather Ramsey, for reaching out and for all of your work in making this event happen. Finally, thanks to my colleagues at New America Foundation who have helped so much with logistics and planning. Special thanks to Sita Pena Gangadharan, Greta Byram, and Hiba Hussein from OTI for your ongoing and significant support. I'll conclude with a few brief housekeeping matters. For those in the room with computers or mobile devices, and for those of you following along via webcast, please join the conversation via Twitter. You can use the hashtag #TW2012. For those tuning in remotely, we'll also try to pull questions for the panelists and Tech Women as they come up on the feed. We intend for this event to be different than most in that Jamie will be working hard to facilitate dialogue among you all, panelists, audience members, and remote viewers. And with that, I'll turn now to our moderator, Jamie Zimmerman. Jamie directs the Global Assets Project and its efforts to advance savings and asset building policies and initiatives around the world. Her current areas of focus include savings-linked conditional cash transfers, child and youth savings policies, foreign aid reform, communities of practice on savings products for the poor, and the role of technology in asset building and development. On to Jamie.
Thank you, Sarah. It's always a pleasure to collaborate with our colleagues at the Open Technology Institute. And I am really especially excited about this event today, Tech for Social Good. And not only because of our esteemed panel, but frankly because it is really awesome and an honor to host an event with such an impressive group of amazing, creative, entrepreneurial women right here at the New America Foundation to discuss these issues. And honestly, for me, it's just exciting to see so many women in the room at these think tank events. They tend to be, I'm looking out at a bunch of men in blue suits. So this is a really lovely on many levels change of scenery for me. Seriously though, this topic, Tech for Social Good, it's a critical one and one of deep personal and professional interest for me. And I'm really glad to take part in this event and that this event is part of your Tech Women, I believe, wrap up tour here in DC. In our work in the Global Assets Project, we dedicate most of our energy to creating new ideas and understanding around opportunities to to provide the disadvantaged, the marginalized, the excluded, with opportunities to build, maximize, leverage their human and financial capital. And new technologies are changing the way we connect with the world, with each other, with our rights, with our opportunities, with micro economies, with macro economies. The list, I think, goes on and on. So our mission within the Global Assets Project is to break the cycles of poverty and exclusion that perpetuate inequalities on many levels. So I think it's fitting to have this discussion today on how we can use technology and innovation for social good. And not just because we have the rare occasion of benefiting from your collective experiences and voices right now, but also because we have the opportunity to look forward. Some of you probably know, maybe all of you know, that Thursday of this week marks the first ever UN International Day of the Girl, which acknowledges the extreme challenges that girls all over the world face. Also the power that they could have should they have the opportunity to unlock their potential. So I'm happy to announce that this week we're releasing our latest paper from our Global Savings and Social Protection Initiative on new ideas for leveraging technology to invest in economic and social empowerment for girls and young women around the world. I'm providing for all of you an early release copy. It doesn't come out officially till Thursday, but if you're interested, there will be some extra copies outside today. So this is going to be a very interactive event, as Sarah mentioned, we hope, and a bit unique among our typical event formats. We're going to spend some time listening to our panelists as they reflect on their experiences using tech for social good, but also going to spend a lot of our time today listening to you and your reflections as well. So just that's the general rundown of the event. There's going to be some Q&A where there's an opportunity for you to ask questions of the panelists, but we'll also be asking you questions. And so please don't be shy. There will be mics running all over the room, and we're really looking forward to hearing from all of you. And you know what your experiences have been, what you've learned, and there'll be more on that later. So from there, let's jump right in. I'd like to ask our panelists, Adarsh, Patty, and Alex, to come up and take your seats. The panelists' bios are included in the agenda packet that all of you received, so I won't read them in detail, but I will quickly introduce everyone. And I'll start to my immediate right with Adarsh Desai, who is a program manager for Innovation Labs at the World Bank, where he manages the Secretariat of the Open Data Technology Initiative, which is focused on technologically enabling citizens, enabling technology among citizens, technologically enabled citizens. The many ways we can say this, I'm finding out right now, and among the World Bank countries. So you know, I can say that I, for one, have been extremely grateful for and an ardent user of the mind-boggling amount of data coming out of the World Bank right now and your efforts to open up your data. And I really look forward to learning more about how these principles are being applied on the ground. Next, we have Patty Mechael, who's the Executive Director of mHealth, a multi-stakeholder alliance using technology to advance global health. I think that explanation doesn't really do it justice, though. This is, I think, one of the most impressive global alliances towards a global development issue that has ever that's ever been created. And so I'm extremely excited to have Patty here today to talk about how the different aspects of that initiative are playing out on the ground. And then finally, at the end is Alex Counts, who's the president and CEO of Grameen Foundation, which is a nonprofit focused on poverty eradication at the intersection of microfinance and technology. Grameen Foundation has always been at the cutting edge of the financial inclusion field, and I'm really eager to hear about the latest and greatest on all of your technology-focused initiatives. So with that, I'll take my seat. And hopefully I'm still mic'd up. Oh, look at that. That is really cool. I never cease to be amazed. And we will turn it over to Adarsh, who's going to speak first. And you can take it away.
Thanks, Jamie. How's everyone doing today?
Great.
Really? Just great? Come on. How's everyone doing today?
Great.
Awesome. That's how it should be. Listen, I'm delighted to be here today and honored to share the stage with Patty, Alex, and Jamie. When I was invited on this panel, I really had no idea about TechWomen. So as I started learning more about it, I just realized how incredible it is. When I started talking to my colleagues and said, this is an awesome program, I'm going to be there. One of them asked, do they know you're not a woman? So I said, I'm sure they know, but maybe how do I say that? I said, okay, fine, I'm going to go nonetheless, because if I say I'm not a woman, maybe I'm not invited and I don't get to be here. So I'm going to... Being a proud father of a daughter and also a technologist, this is truly exciting and honoring for me to be here among some of the very talented individuals. It's incredibly inspiring. I was going through your biography, the biodata that was shared, your profiles, to see that, you know, inspired to see your passion. Coming from India, I can imagine how challenging it must be for all of you to kind of walk on the path that you've chosen. I hope that my daughter grows up and has a similar conviction and passion as you have today. I'm happy to share my work. I'm speaking on behalf of a lot of my colleagues and clients, the work that we do at the World Bank and engaging with our clients. So what I'll try to do is to kind of give you short kind of snippets of about World Bank, about the work and so on, and then there's time later on where we can go into some of the details if that's something that you'd like to do. And I'm also hopefully learn more from you today than I share. So World Bank, as many of you might know, it's not a bank in the traditional sense. We are kind of an international development institution. We essentially work with developing countries, provide financial, as in loans and grants, and technical assistance, as in knowledge, advisory services, etc. We typically operate through six regions, one of them being MENA, Africa, South Asia, Latin America, East Asia, Pacific, and Eastern Europe and Central Asia. Those are kind of how we structured ourselves. And then the networks would focus more on health issues, social protection, things like that. I work at a part of the World Bank, or a place of the World Bank called World Bank Institute. We do not do lending. We do a lot of capacity building activities for our clients. So we tend to engage not only with the governments, but also with other stakeholders, like civil society groups, community groups, private sector sometimes, as well as city administration, things like that. So we are kind of unique in that sense from the World Bank. There are very few places like us in the bank that engage with other important stakeholders, but except aside from the government. We kind of have roughly three areas of services. One around open knowledge, connecting people from south-south, north-south type of thing. Collaborative governance, how can we bring citizens' voice into the whole policy making type of thing. And innovative solutions, trying sometimes emerging technologies to test out new things that might have impact on the ground. We believe that technology can have a big impact if it's anchored in a policy reform, right? And the examples that I show will give you a sense of what I mean by that. Obviously, the events from the Arab Spring, we have seen that we have seen the transformational power of technology when a large number of people have access to it and ability to use it. We're trying to see if we can create an environment on the other side where the governments are receptive to hear the voice of the citizens. So some of the questions we ask ourselves is, how can we use technology for improved transparency, access to information? How can we use it for improving citizen participation in policy making, as well as around public service delivery? And how can we use it ultimately to improve accountability? The program that I work on and I manage at the World Bank, which is called the Open Development Technology Alliance, or ODTA, short form, that's precisely what we are trying to answer such questions and say, how can we use technology for ICT-enabled citizen engagement, right? So technology is an enabler, not an end in itself, right? That's an important thing to remember. As somebody said earlier, Jamie said, I think or Sarah said, that it's people that matter, not the technology. We focus at all levels of development, early stage policy making, kind of trying to support early stage policy making where we can bring citizen voice to more like this service delivery, did I get the water today or did I receive the health services type of thing. We believe that the opportunity is big But a lot of the expertise, the knowledge is outside the bank. Like you see a lot of innovations happening in the countries, not inside the World Bank, right? You can, examples of M-Pesa in Kenya, World Bank didn't create it. And there are many, many such great examples out there. So what we're trying to see is how can we create some kind of a platform where we can bring the external knowledge, the expertise, and kind of pair it with the people in the bank who work with the clients, right? So we do it around kind of three areas broadly, like we call the knowledge, people, and tools. Around knowledge, we try to not only produce knowledge based on what we have learned, but also curate knowledge of things that have worked outside. And normally, bank does a lot of analytical research-oriented work, but in our case, we are trying to focus on more on not necessarily the know-how, but kind of the do-how, like more practical stuff. People, it's around creating a community, having a pool of experts who can work with the countries, and tools, creating some sort of an app store model, right? Let me give you some examples. Might anchor this a little bit because a lot of it is conceptual, what I just said earlier. So we recently engaged with the water kind of unit in our, you know, one of the water units in the bank, and they said we have a lot of issues around water delivery, water servicing. Some of them could be addressed to some kind of a technology intervention, maybe software of tracking what's working, what's not working, things like that. Went through a series of exercise where we created kind of the problem statements, and then we had these hackathons in 10 countries. One of them was Egypt. We brought the kind of the local utilities, the consumer, the bank folks, and others to kind of work on these problems and say, can we come up with a solution in 24 hours, 48 hours type of model, right? We got about 60 solutions. This was global event, so it's not only Egypt, but we had another, I think, 8 or 10 countries. And we got a lot of good ideas, a lot of good solutions. Some are being pursued by the local authority, like the water utilities, et cetera, to kind of adopt them as a way of doing it. Similarly, we did transport hackathon also. I believe Egypt was one of the countries. And we're doing something around sanitation that's upcoming. Another example comes from Democratic Republic of Congo. As many of us know, it's a relatively poor country. But this example is great that you can see that given all the constraints they have, they were able to do something. So what they did is they came up with a participatory budgeting process where the citizens get to vote and kind of debate on what the local issues are and how certain percentage of the budget should be allocated to meet their needs. Not what the government thinks, but what they think should be invested. And a lot of this was done using simple SMSs. They learned about it, they voted through SMS, they got feedback through SMS, etc. So again, you can see that even in a constrained environment, there's a lot can be done if there is a will. Interesting examples come, another interesting one is from India. In the state of Karnataka, there was this challenge of saying if there's an issue around how do you verify that the health services were delivered to pregnant women? Like how can you make sure that they're receiving the service that they're supposed to? So using a mobile device and a smart card type of thing, there's pilot that started a few months ago, which says if the woman receives the delivery, the nurse goes to the home and say, you know, you're supposed to have a 3-month visit and we are here, then there's a proof, like a biometric validation, not through the smart card, but also fingerprint and say, yes, we received. And they get to vote on saying whether they were happy with it or not. So there's like the smiley face and a frowny face and an angry face type of thing, right? But what we observed is in that case that most people were uncomfortable saying something bad about the service that they had just received in front of the person. So instituted a phone calling system where, you know, every Sunday, 8 o'clock, sometime those who have received get a phone call, and through the voice kind of IVR system, they were able to provide further kind of, you know, non-biased feedback, if you will. Those are kind of, and there are other examples as well. There's another thing most of you might have heard of Code for America. It's become very popular in America, and we're trying to see if that similar model can be done in Africa. So we're calling it the Code for Africa. It's still at a conceptual stage, but the idea is more or less the same. We are learning a lot from them.
I have to start to cut you off because for the sake of time.
I'm almost done.
Okay.
Great.
So here's the sales pitch. I would invite all of you to join the ODTA group, the Open Development Technology Alliance group on LinkedIn. It's on LinkedIn, it's easy to join. That way we can stay in touch. And also I want to thank Department of State New America Foundation for giving me this opportunity to be here. Really, as I said, this is incredible. And I wish you all the best in your journeys and hope you can stay in touch through LinkedIn, Twitter, other channels. And I can't wait to go home and tell my daughter about this experience. Hope it's inspirational. So thank you. Thanks.
Great. Thank you, Adarsh. And I hope that everyone takes an opportunity to ask you. It sounds like you have a repertoire of more examples and interesting things that you'd be able to tell us a little bit more about during the Q&A. But for now, I'll ask Patty to take the podium or stay in your seat, whatever you'd like to do, and hear about mHealth and the use of technology to advance public health.
Great. Okay. First of all, I'd really like to thank you, Jamie and Sarah, for the introductions, and thank the TechWomen program and State Department and the New Americas Foundation for inviting me to speak. We have a saying in Arabic that indicates to one's visitors that they have shed light into one's home or city or country, depending on how far they have traveled. And so to our colleagues from the Middle East and North Africa, Nawartuna. And yes, while my name is not particularly a good indication, especially since there is no P in the Arabic alphabet, I am Egyptian. And I am the daughter of a tech woman and a tech man, and the sister of a tech woman. And so most of my family comes from the electrical engineering computer science background. And actually it was that passion that motivated my father to immigrate to America in the first place. So he had studied computers in the Faculty of Agriculture in the 1960s and decided that rather than work in agriculture, what he really wanted to do was to work in computers. And then when my mother came to the US, she decided when my sister and I were 3 and 4 that she wasn't cut out to be a stay-at-home mom and really wanted to have a career. And so my father encouraged her to pursue computer science. And so then she became a computer scientist herself, working with computers in the day when computers were the size of rooms. And now we live in a day where computers are the size of, they're about this big. So just a little bit about myself. I'm actually not technically a tech woman, although I work on tech aspects of public health. I'm actually, my background is in international health. And about, I want to say, a little over 10 years ago, I went back to school to do a PhD and was looking at mobile phones and health and the ways in which cell phones, even already at that time, were starting to improve access to health services and information and transportation, et cetera. And I did my field work in Egypt, in Minya, at a time when the penetration rates in Egypt as a country were 3.4%. So you can imagine that things have changed dramatically since 2002, 2003, when I actually conducted my field research. So since that time, we'll fast forward to about a year ago, when I became the executive director of the mHealth Alliance, which was formed about 3 years ago to serve as an umbrella organization to really look at the enabling environment to support the advancement of the use of mobile technologies to meet global health challenges. And so it was started by the Vodafone Foundation, the UN Foundation, and the Rockefeller Foundation to convene many members of the mHealth ecosystem. So if you can imagine, you have everyone from the technologists to the health people, and a lot of translation issues happening in between the two. You have academics engaged in this field looking to evaluate the impact that it's having in terms of people's health. You have policymakers, various ministries that are all looking to see how they can leverage this tool that now seems to be in the hands of billions of people. I don't think anybody could have anticipated that people would prioritize access to communication as much as they have. And so now you'll see things which from a public health perspective are quite interesting, like there are now more mobile phones than there are toilets in the world. You know, and so if you think about, people have access to communication, but they don't have access to water and sanitation, which is a major building block from a public health perspective. And so our role within the mHealth Alliance is to address some of the major challenge areas that are being faced by organizations trying to leverage mobile technology to support health. And so we work on sort of five major program focus areas. The first is around evidence. So we have a lot of folks who really want to leverage mobile technology to support health, but they don't know where to begin, they don't know how to begin, they don't know what's worked, how it's worked, why it's worked. And so we have sort of a whole work stream looking at identifying gaps in the evidence and then mobilizing researchers to actually conduct studies that can help us become better informed users of mobile technology for health. The second area is around standards and interoperability. And I never thought in a million years that I would become one of these people that runs around cheering for more standards. but we have a situation now where we have lots of mHealth programs, applications, platforms being implemented throughout the world. None of them talk to each other, and none of the data is standardized, so you can't aggregate the data up the chain to then get a really good comprehensive picture of what is happening in the world in terms of health statistics and indicators. All the building blocks are there, but we haven't actually put them together in a very systematic way. The other three areas, because I see I'm being asked to stop now, but the other three areas that we focus on are around sustainable financing models. At the moment, a lot of mHealth is financed by private philanthropies and or through corporate social responsibility programs. And what we're trying to do is to look and see if there is a case for social marketing to government so that governments actually, due to the cost savings that they can garner or to the reach that they can have through mobile technology, that they are incentivized to actually pay for some of these services. But then also looking to see if there's a business case to incentivize some of the telecommunications industry partners to think about how they can systematically invest in some of these technologies. And then we work in the areas of capacity building and policy. And so through all these building blocks, we'd like to see happen, you know, in the next few years, and things are moving very quickly, is that we'll rapidly see a mainstreaming of mHealth where, you know, me as an individual, you as an individual can really start to actually experience the benefits of it, because it's one of those things that is in the interest of every individual to see how it's going to work, because we're going to be affected by, you know, health issues in one way or another, either because we're trying to prevent something and keep ourselves healthy, or we find ourselves pregnant and maybe in need of messaging throughout our pregnancies, or we come down with a non-communicable disease like diabetes and need some kind of platform that can help us manage our chronic condition and can connect us in a systematic way with the larger health system. So just want to thank you all, El Fashuk, and I look forward to the question and answer.
Thank you, Patty. All right, last but not least, Alex Counts.
Terrific, thank you. And it's a pleasure to be with you all on this panel. I just, one disclosure before we get going, I had some dental work done a couple of hours ago.
Oh.
So this side of my face is coming out of being numb, and my doctor, the dentist, said, that people have a tendency to drool on themselves while this is happening. So if you see me looking strange, it doesn't necessarily mean how I feel about being on this panel.
Not necessarily.
Also, I'm really appreciating the opportunity to bring some gender balance to this room. So what will I say? I think to echo a couple of themes, you know, Grameen Foundation, which has been known, and Grameen Bank, known for microfinance, 11 years ago we launched a major technology program, information technology. And the guy we hired to run it said something to me, which has been borne out ever since, which is to make technology work for the poor, the technology is usually the easy part. And he said that, and I've seen it. One of the things that I've seen is very important is to bring technology to disadvantaged groups so they actually use it and understand it. It requires on-the-ground groups, can be government, or in many cases better civil society groups, to sensitize them, to help them understand it. And in that context, I have to use this moment to say how unfortunate it is that in Bangladesh right now, the government of Bangladesh is acting extremely hostily to one of the great civil society organizations. Grameen Bank is a step or two away from nationalizing it. And I also would be remiss of me not to say that the U.S. Department of State and the World Bank have been stood very strong for an independent Grameen Bank, and hopefully that will prevail. The other thing that's very important beyond the local presence to make technology work is relationships. We, 11 years ago when we were launching our technology program, we had no presence in the Middle East and North Africa. It was kind of off of the Grameen Foundation radar. And we were approached by a company, and a family company, a very large one, the Abdul Latif Jamil Group, based in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia. And they said, we want to join hands with you and bring microfinance and other social innovations to the Arab world. And we were initially a little bit wary, and our wariness probably made them wary. But within a short amount of time, we developed a very strong friendship and relationship with them that is now 10 years going strong. They also have very strong ties to MIT, and that's where I was yesterday to make some linkages with one of their other big philanthropic orientations partners. And we have had tremendous success, and I think more than either of us could have done independently. They know the region and the business climate, and we know microfinance and social innovation, and joined together, and we've created something called Grameen Jamil Pan-Arab Microfinance Limited, based in Dubai, it's been a great joy to see that organization develop. Now, what have we been doing in the tech space? Let me just get a couple of points. As you may know, Grameen Phone, an offshoot of Grameen Bank, started a major cell phone company, which was a big commercial success, called Grameen Phone, and on the side set up 300,000 Bangladeshi women to be human payphones, to get a cell phone that they would then rent out for a call or something to their people in the neighborhood. We took that, the first in the world, took that outside of Bangladesh to Uganda. This is where relationships are important, because it wasn't necessarily the country that would made most sense, but MTN, a dominant telecom there, was so excited to do this, to be the first in the world, rolled out the red carpet for us, and we threw out our matrix about which country to go into, and said, we want to work with people who want to work with us. And we started out, and we made a ton of mistakes. In Bangladesh, it seemed to be enough to kind of throw the phone over the wall, and the women were off making calls, and Uganda, you know, the cow steps on the phone, it doesn't work, and how do you, you know, and then the signage was very important for the payphone. But we ultimately got it right. 80,000 phones rolled out as a new income source, and women being sensitized to being a link to their community to technology. We saw the payphone business going down because everyone was getting their own phone. So we said, let's use the data possibilities of the phone, and we developed something with Google and MTN. A couple of applications to get information about agriculture, health, and commerce over your phone with a free form SMS. You didn't need web browsing capability. And what we found when we rolled it out nationwide, any farmer, anyone with a health question could search this. And what we found, to summarize a lot of research, was that it increased knowledge in these domains, but didn't change behavior. Right? That's the kind of the holy grail is behavior change. So we then said, well, we kind of failed. So then we said, let's take the agriculture domain and create what is now 850 community knowledge workers. These are kind of paraprofessionals, agricultural extensionists, who basically take the phone and visit farmers and actually let them ask the questions, but walk them through the process. And what we found is, in adding that human element to bring the technology there, it actually has changed behavior. Crop choices have changed. Not only knowledge has changed, but farmers were getting 40% higher prices by being able to use their community knowledge worker to find out which market to sell their crops. And they were growing higher value-added crops. So that was a big learning for us. On the health sphere, we went off to Ghana, where I was just a couple of days ago. And we created something called the MoTech, Mobile Technologies for Community Health, which is basically a mobile midwife type of project where you enroll women who are expectant mothers into a system, and it does a couple things. It gives them reminders throughout their pregnancy of what to do and what not to do, which have proven very useful, and again, people. And then secondly, in fact, it's interesting, you get a message every week, and if you opt in, you can get a secondary message, of which two-thirds of the women opt in to listen to that second message. And then another half of them opt in for a third message. So this isn't like junk mail equivalent. People are really using this. The other thing is it enters these women into a database, which then sends reminders to the Ghana Health Service frontline nurses that someone missed an appointment, they're in their seventh month, what's going on. And so it's also creating, in a couple of districts so far, a kind of electronic medical records for poor women and throughout rural Ghana before we have them here in the United States, really, which is exciting. All of it being entered on a mobile phone. And I visited one center, a health center, which is one of the first, which by using this now for about 9 months, they've actually gone totally paperless in how they work with pregnant mothers and with newborn children in that community, which was a big joy for the women because for a time they were doing both, and now they threw out all the paper. I'll just one last word, and I won't even get to what we're doing in Indonesia on the mobile livelihoods micro-franchise, but on the interoperability thing, I have to say I really agree. And what the people that have been looking at what we did in Ghana on the execution side with the mobile midwife and the Ghana Health Service, and by the way, our goal is to institutionalize this within the Ghana Health Service and have them take it over. That's our sustainability strategy, so it's not just a one-off little thing. But people that know this much better than I feel that we got the underlying technology of the platform of how to do this as pretty good, and so we have now the BBC and their philanthropic arm, Johnson & Johnson and CARE, partnering with us, doing their mobile health programs in Bihar on the MoTech platform. So they didn't reinvent the whole underlying technology or just using ours and the open source nature of it, which we think is one small step towards doing this in a more in not such a fragmented way. And even my colleague, who's the lead on this whole program, is in a two-day meeting hosted by the Gates Foundation today, or this is the first day, with one of the largest humanitarian organizations in the world, migrating all of their mobile health work to the MoTech platform. So I think that if we can move beyond, this is one area where let 1,000 flowers bloom may have been the way to start, I don't know, but it's not the way to scale. And again, we're trying to play a role in that.
Great, thank you. Thank you to all of our panelists. I have a number of questions, but maybe for the sake of time, let me see just a quick show of hands who in the audience has questions for our panelists to start. Okay, good. So I'll start with one, and then we'll get rolling for a little bit of Q&A, and then we have some questions for you. I think that there's a lot of exciting. I love this panel because there's such a breadth of issues that we're all trying to address and to find solutions to. And one thing that I'm hearing, mobile solutions, platforms, interoperability, biometric, tech, and all these different tools that can be used. And then I'm hearing about
the variety of stakeholders. We're talking about people, you know, the actual users of the technology on the ground, the governments who want to increase their transparency and their accountability, the multilaterals, the NGOs who are, you know, leveraging these platforms. I mean, it seems like the private sector who is obviously, you know, wanting to capitalize on these opportunities as well. So the scope of opportunities seems incredibly immense. And I think that you spent, I think, gave some really amazing examples of, you know, how each of your different organizations and those affiliated with your organizations are taking advantage of those opportunities. I'm curious if each of you could just say what your biggest, what you think either for your organization or for what you're trying to achieve broadly, what the biggest challenge is. What is the biggest challenge that's keeping either your specific initiative, your organization, or the field in which you find yourself operating from taking the scope of opportunities and you know, changing everything overnight? Yeah, sure. We can just go down the line. That's fine.
Well, I won't speak on behalf of the World Bank. It's too large an institution to say this is the problem, but I can speak for my program around the, you know, kind of technology for citizen engagement or social accountability. Many factors, but one of them being convincing the government that it's good to listen to the voices of the citizens. Because, you know, starting one-way traffic of providing a mobile platform or a web platform is easy. But if nobody responds to that, then it doesn't solve the problem, right? It doesn't serve the purpose. So what we're trying to set up is kind of two-way communications where essentially everyone will benefit from that conversation, right? So that is one big challenge. The other big challenge is finding the people to support such programs in the country, right? As I said when I was talking earlier, a lot of expertise doesn't reside with the bank. You can't only find so many people in America, let's say, to even fly around. So it's important to have people who understand the local context, because at the end of the day, it's not about technology, right? I mean, technology, as Alex said, is the easy part. So I think, let me stop here and say, these are kind of two, and there are other constraints as well around, you know, how do you fund and so on and so forth. But I feel like these are two major constraints for us to kind of, you know, scale up.
Patty? I think from where I sit in this space, I think there's a lot of hype right now around mobile technologies and mobile health as the solution, as if somehow miraculously running around and distributing cell phones to health workers is going to completely revolutionize the way that health services are delivered or accessed or done. And I think we're starting to see a much more tempered view and a much more realistic approach to mobile health, which is really exciting exciting for me. I have a really good colleague at UNICEF, which has done, I mean, UNICEF Innovations has done a great deal of work in mHealth and probably have some of the largest mHealth implementations that are now moving towards scale. And she and I joke with each other that we should co-author a book entitled mHealth is Hard, because it actually is quite hard, because you're dealing, as Adarsh was saying, a lot of people issues. So it's not the technology components that are really, really complicated. It's that if you put the technology systems in place, are the health workers fully trained to be able to use it effectively? Do the people trust the sources of information that they're being asked to phone into? And is the government secure enough in its position to open itself up to accountability and scrutiny by the people? Because that's ultimately what's going to start to happen as this data gets aggregated and people see some of the disparities, etc. This is going to become a critical issue.
Make a book called How to Make
Them. There you go.
Two things briefly. As we collect data on whether it's the pregnant mothers or it's the farmers in Uganda, in fact, community knowledge workers in Uganda, we actually get contracts for them to do periodic surveys of other farmers, which is something that a lot of companies in Kampala are willing to pay for. And so there's a sustainability aspect of it. But one of the things we're bumping into is the rapidly changing and very fragmented privacy laws in the world. This information aggregated and if it's put in an analyzable form can lead to a lot better services, more customized services to people, but we're going to have to figure out a way. And right now, I mean, the laws in Colombia are just changing, and we're needing to change our thing. We're hardly even underway there. So working through that piece, and I don't have a cookie cutter solution, but it could become a real barrier. The second thing is, building in the sustainability aspect of this so these aren't kind of one-off things that fall off the cliff. In Indonesia, I'll just say we were going to launch the last of the village phone programs, but by the time we got it going, the payphone market was gone. And so we said, what the heck are we going to do? And we helped start a local social enterprise called Ruma, and which is its own great story. But we said the simplest thing, even though it isn't creating value like health information or agricultural information, is actually allow women to sell airtime from them to their neighbors in increments as little as 10 cents, and which is actually was a real need. And we found we do a intake survey of people's poverty level using a tool we call the Progress Out of Poverty Index on the phone when these entrepreneurs come in. And in fact, while they're a little tech savvy, two-thirds of them live under $1.25 a day. And what we found is just by viewing how much airtime they were reselling, and we knew what their margins were, 40% of them were increasing their income enough to come out of poverty within 6 months. So this was the killer app. Even though it's just getting airtime from one to the other that, so people can, yap on the phone a little bit more. But what happens then is that once you have the financial sustainability built in an application like that, then adding on top of it some things that might not earn a lot of money, whether it's around, health information, agriculture, the app we're rolling out now is more of a kind of monster.com, but for casual laborers in this part of Indonesia, matching them with the demand. But you got to have that thing there that pays the bills. Otherwise, these things can have a really one-off, really time-limited project-like quality to them.
Great. So let's open it up for just a few questions. Let's see those hands again. Okay, we'll start with you. And we'll just take three. Please stand up, introduce yourself, since we do have a live stream that's happening, and maybe say where you're from and what your interest area is or your entrepreneurial area in which you, So yeah, please go ahead.
So thanks. My name is Vera Ghazal. I'm from Lebanon, part of the TechWomen delegation. I work at Oracle Middle East. I'm a technology consultant. I cover the area of Levant and North Africa. I have a question for Alex, actually. So I noticed that within your projects in enabling housewives and farmers and handymen with such handheld devices, let us say handheld device, with basic messaging in order to enhance their domestic lives and their businesses. So we're assuming that they have to have a certain level of literacy for that. And how do you deal with people, such kind of people are illiterate? Are you collaborating with other programs for literacy? Thanks.
Okay, and we'll just take a couple, and then we'll, if that's okay. So let's go the third row back here.
Hi, my name is Ishita Majumdar, and I'm a, excuse me for my bad throat. I'm a tech mentor in this program, and I've been associated with cellular technology since the beginning of my career, which is a long, long time ago, since the days when cell phones were uncool, unsmart, and Wi-Fi was a strange acronym. Your discussion is very inspiring. I've been part of a lot of these discussions as my focus was emerging markets. And I come to you as a technologist, as an engineer, and I ask you, if you had a wish list for technology enablers across devices, networks, services, applications, security, what would they be? What would you tell me and say, go and build me this or go and improve this?
That's a good one. Wow. Okay. And do we have one more? Okay, let's go to the back. Yes, you, ma'am.
I'm Hoyda Ahmed. I'm from Palestine. I'm a TechWomen participant. Actually, my question is directed to Adarsh. How can the World Bank be sure that there is a much transparency in the execution process in the destination country, please? Thank you.
Okay, great. Okay, so we'll start with that for now. Alex, why don't you go ahead and take the first sure. The first question.
First of all, yeah, literacy is a real issue, and we've found some workarounds, but we're not totally satisfied. First of all, though, I think one of the insights for us is that if people are illiterate, they may be numerate. They may be able to use an SMS in different ways, and if they can't, their children may be able to. So it's if you can create the demand, there are some ways people can get around that. But we did find when we rolled out the mobile midwife in Ghana, you know, we gave people the option to get their messages through SMS or voicemail, and we negotiated with the telecom that it'd be free in either case. Well, 99% wanted voicemail. And what was interesting, and this is kind of, is that we thought it might be 50-50. We didn't know the simple messages, but also it mattered a lot the accent of the voice. There are many dialects in Ghana, whether it was a male or female, what age did it sound like, and basically we found the killer voice was someone who sounded like your kind of kindly auntie. Who was not like so overeducated, but not undereducated, and that was a huge amount of research that went into that. And I think also on top of that, in terms of, I think our other big lesson in this space is it goes back to the importance of the trusted intermediary, whether it's the Ghana Health Service nurse or the community knowledge worker in the community. You know, if you have one farmer who is literate. And it gets the prestige of having the phone, and then we give them a charging solution, or her, which makes a little money on the side charging other people's cell phones. That person can really bridge the gaps of discoverability, that it exists, and then literacy, and then contextualization, and all of that to actually go from, again, that's the big jump, from knowledge increase, at best, to behavior change. And so doing this without the trusted intermediary, without utilizing either those civil servants or civil society, and taking advantage of the fact that there are literate people in those that actually go out to these places, that was one of our big lessons in rolling this out.
So let's move to Adarsh, since there was a question specifically for you on transparency and the processes that you use at the World Bank.
That's a good question. We are doing multiple things to kind of make the work that we do or the work we support in developing countries more transparent. At the same time, we are also working with the countries to kind of make their information more transparent. I'll give you some examples. So as Jamie mentioned earlier, we started with our own data, right? And we said, how can we start, in some sense, eat our own dog food? We've been talking about this for a long time, but we still sell our data. It's not freely accessible. How can we do it? So we started with opening up our data, because if we don't do it, we can't go to a country and say, you should open up your data, by the way, right? So we started with that. Kenya is one of the recent big story on open data. And our opening data, for example, it's just a starting point, right? There are a lot of components to transparency. One is access to information. So we advise, we work with the countries too, so that they pass access to information laws. Like Bangladesh has one of the success stories around access to information, for example. So is India and many other countries. When it comes to data, there are a lot of things that have to happen. One, there should be some access to information policy. There needs to be legal policy around what data can be opened up, how fast, whether the data quality is good, and so on and so forth. The other aspect of this thing, can we make our project information as transparently available? It's already available, but doesn't mean that it's actually accessible or it's easy to understand. So we're trying to also, So one of the initiatives that one of my colleagues, we did it within the innovation labs, is called Mapping for Results. And if you look at it, it's called maps.worldbank.org. And essentially it put all projects on the map, and it also puts key indicators on the map. So sometimes you see that there are a lot of health projects in an area but that's relatively well off compared to other area which is poorer, but there are no health projects, for example. Maybe there's a reason, maybe not, but at least that starts people to ask such questions. We are spending more kind of resources to saying, how can we make our interim indicators that we track for every project more transparent, more visually, easily understandable, right? We're also doing another kind of project, which is called the Open Aid Partnership, where if you see that in many countries, especially poor countries, sometimes their core budget, about 60, sometimes 70% of the core budget comes from foreign aid, right, including the bank, but there are many other donors who put the money. But there is no single place to see today where all the money is coming from and where how the money is being used, right? So we looked at Malawi as an example, and we mapped, and it's fascinating, again, we mapped all the aid that went to the country and mapped the poverty indicators, and you can see that sometimes people are working on the same thing in the same area, but they didn't really know about it, right? So we're trying to address this whole issue of transparency, accountability in many different ways, because there's no one size fits all, or there's no silver bullet type of solution. Hope I answered the question.
And great, and we have an offer on the table for a tech mentor to build for you exactly what you need to do the things you want to do. So tell her, let's make that pitch. What is it that if you were to tell her, what would you go and build this for me? What would it be? Let's start with Patty, and then we'll wrap around.
I'll actually tell you a story to sort of contextualize my response to you. In 2006, I have the privilege, and I continue to do this now, to go and spend some time in the Ministry of Communication Information Technology in Egypt. And they have incubation projects every year that come in, and so they've invited me to come and review and advise on their health-related initiatives. And so, in 2006, I was invited to go and take a look at one of these initiatives. And it was a team of four, two engineers, a cardiologist, and a public health person. And they were working on a mobile cardiac monitor. And so it was interesting, because when I was sitting there talking to them, I started, the social scientist in me came out and started asking them questions about this application that they were working on. And I, you know, was just like, well, have you spent much time in the hospitals or the health facilities observing the work of the cardiologists? Have you interviewed some of the patients that you expect to put these things on themselves at home to see how they're going to react to this? And very quickly, it became quite clear that they had a technology that they were developing in search of a problem that they were trying to solve. And so I couldn't tell you right now for a specific place that here's the killer application that is going to transform things, but I can say from the health perspective that really understanding the context of the problem and understanding some of the issues that have been raised, including some of the literacy issues. I actually worked on the ethnography for the MoTeC project in Ghana, where the project itself was originally intended to be a text message-based program, but through the ethnographic process, we discovered that there were literacy issues and there was a strong preference to get the information via voice. And so even if they designed the system in a way where they were delivering these messages, the utilization may not have been as high. I have a colleague who talks about designing technology and building it under the mango tree, but really spending time and engaging in agile processes tends to work quite well, where you can really understand the context and the issues that are being raised by the people who ultimately are going to benefit from the technology.
So Alex or Adarsh, do either of you have a killer app that you want to make a pitch for?
Well, I'll be very brief. If some of my hardcore kind of technology colleagues were here, they'd probably take this in a different direction, but coming from Ghana just a couple of days ago, I swear to God, and if anyone has this, if someone can find a solar charger that can actually charge cell phones, a single one that works, that would be, I don't need anything else. And I swear, I think we're on our 10th one, and everyone has promised that this is the one that's robust, that'll work, and we went and saw this guy who's building a business around charging the cell phones of the Ghana Health Service nurses and the women. And, you know, there we were, and 2 months after he got it, oop, the solar panel doesn't work anymore. And he had to take it an hour into town every day to charge it from an outlet and bring it back because the demand was there. So if someone can work on one of those, I'll be really a happy guy.
Well, that's great. Well, with that, you know, I think one thing that you said, Patty, that it's really interesting, you know, that strikes a chord is, in your story, that you know, someone having a technology and using it to, you know, in search of a problem you're trying to solve. And I really think that this is a really good opportunity for us to kind of pivot this conversation and take it back out to all of you as the experts on on technology and access to and use of technology in your home countries, in your communities, in your region, and ask you, I guess I would look at maybe a couple different ways, what are the problems that technology can or should solve in your regions, and do you have any of your own ideas for some killer apps to do that? I would love to hear your thoughts on this. So let's get that started, and maybe, I don't know if maybe the person who posed the original question might have some initial thoughts to launch us off, or if someone would like to volunteer.
I don't have a good voice.
So we'll have a mic for you.
Is it on?
Yes. Yeah.
The reason I asked that question is precisely of what you mentioned, Patty. A lot of us today, we sit in our back of our research labs, and we draw an emerging market and its problem on the whiteboard, and we design these low-cost phones for $10 or $15, and with a lot of language. We did one for India. We had 5 language capabilities, and we thought we solved the problem. And then we go to the market, we go to our salespeople, and they are like, why don't you talk to us? And we learned a very good lesson, and I said that we will have to go and talk to the people on the road to understand that. When I asked you that question is, I belong to a research lab, and I'm always looking at bigger pipes, low-cost pipes which can do a lot of data. So I look at networks a lot. I look at devices, not necessarily only the smart devices. I don't think smartphones will apply to the regions where you go. What can we do on the non-smart devices using voice, using SMS, using other telepresence, video, if we have a low-cost video application. We did a few from my experience. I am very proud of putting a solar-powered base station in Namibia. I spent 3 months there. And what we did is not only powered the cell phones, with the extra storage stored and harnessed power, we actually powered the villages around it. And that was something I'm very proud of. And I moved away from the project and moved away from the company, but my passion still remains, so thank you.
We have another.
Hi, I'm Zain Ahmed from Lebanon. I have a PhD in structure, function, and proteins engineering. I have a faculty position at St. Joseph University of Beirut, and I do research in anti-HIV drug design. So my question is to Patty, of course, we always need like technology to improve the health, the quality of life in our countries, also in Lebanon. But concerning like when it comes to Africa and AIDS, I'm so passionate, so I will skip this part and I will go directly to my question. Are there any like mHealth for infectious diseases and especially for AIDS in particular, for example, or other kind of diseases?
Yeah, actually, HIV was one of the first areas to apply mobile technology to address it, and probably has the largest amount of evidence to support that it's actually showing results. So things like treatment adherence. So because AIDS treatment is the sort of thing that you have to take systematically and routinely, mm-hmm. Enrolling people in reminder programs is a huge piece of it. Also, even just in mobilizing people to come in for testing, for counseling, to just understand their status. But we're also starting to see interesting uses of some of the social network capabilities of cell phones for support groups for people who are HIV positive, emerging in environments like South Africa, where they now have more feature phones and smartphones than they do basic handsets, because data is actually cheaper than voice or text messaging. And so they're gaming the system in some ways, but they're also getting higher capabilities through their mobiles.
So I have another question, but I hope you don't get me wrong. Mm-hmm. So is it like you think it's better to give these people mobiles instead of giving them like access to therapies? Like if the therapy costs around $600 and an African man's salary is around $100, mm-hmm. so it's like he'll never get to afford for himself the multi-therapy thing. Mm-hmm. So it's better to give him a mobile and like to implement this awareness mentality or concept instead of giving him the therapy, one. And two, is this working? Like the awareness thing or the awareness campaign is like really doing a great job or is successful? Do you find like good results?
Well, we don't actually, I don't encourage people to distribute mobile phones, particularly if you're looking at the general population, just because it becomes a very expensive undertaking. I think a lot of people have prioritized cell phones on their own, so just really piggybacking on the technologies that they already have is sort of part of that. In terms of behavior change, that is one of the biggest challenge areas that we're currently facing, where you have a lot of discussion, a lot of hope that mobile technology is going to be able to change behaviors. But very little data or evidence that it's actually working. And so there are now a number of studies that are trying to look at the connection between not just the increase in knowledge, as Alex was talking about earlier, but what is it that it actually takes to engage people in healthier lifestyles and in preventative types of activities. And so that there are a number of studies that are ongoing right now, but we're still there's still a big question mark. And then back to the killer application, I've actually thought of one for you. If you can build security into the devices, that would be huge. And one of the biggest challenges that we're facing is that a lot of the particularly for basic handsets, there isn't security built in for transactions either via SMS or via voice. And it was in the United States, actually, that there was advocacy movements made that sort of pushed BlackBerry to create a secure BlackBerry system, where now all of the BlackBerries are secure, encrypted platforms. And so that may actually be, particularly on the health side, where privacy and confidentiality and security issues are really important to address.
Great, now we have some more hands popping up. Let's start here in the front. Where's our mic runner? Not running, apparently. Okay, here we go. And around, and we'll start here. All right.
Awesome. Hi, Ayori Selassie. I'm one of the mentors here with TechWomen, and I hear everyone on the panel reiterating that the real complexity is not the creation of technology, but it's really the delivering that engagement. And I'm wondering if there are, we talked about transparency a lot, which is a very critical issue. Now, what transparency do we currently have into these other countries, such as Middle East and North Africa, that would help us to, as we're building these technologies, to actually get them into the hands of the folks who are on the ground? Or are those groups things that we need to also be involved in creating?
So you want to have a thought on that?
Well, I think, let me just offer one. you know, the civil, if I understood your question correctly, I think civil society groups, well, let me just say, there are a lot of myths about the Middle East and North Africa here in the United States, if I can say one thing, and perhaps there are myths in both directions, but one of them is, again, just on the microfinance side, people saying that, you know, how can you ever have a situation where women in the Middle East, North Africa will take up loans and will society accept that? It turns out to be much easier to do that than in India, and much less controversial. And so that was kind of a, and the other thing is that there are civil society groups that can play this kind of trusted intermediary role. They are there. They may not be as widespread and as national or pan-regional in scope as some other regions, but they're there. And I think let's start leveraging the ones that are there, and then whether they're in microfinance or health, whatever, to utilize some of these emerging technologies, get them familiar with it, get them, and I think they'll, you know, this civil society sector will happen. I think there's also just a, in terms of transparency, you know, because we want to create some transparency ourselves around the poverty reduction track record of our programs that are focused on livelihoods, we created this tool called the Progress Out of Poverty Index. That it's a 10-question survey based on census data, and we found that you know, some countries didn't want to give us that data. Without the data, we can't build the tool and the transparency that comes. And yet, we, in several cases after the Arab Spring, when things were in this kind of chaotic situation, we were able to, you know, utilizing our local partner, to actually get the information that we've been trying to get for 6 years. And someone said, oh, sure, it's right here. Just hand it over to us. Egypt was a great example. So I think there are probably some openings in terms of civil society organizations, transparency, that are there right now that weren't there 2 years ago. But again, I think that there are a lot of opportunities that people, that 5 years ago I would have missed, to partner with civil society groups. And with emerging technology leaders that are in the region that I just don't think are on the radar screen.
And I think it's a really great and important question, and another opportunity, I think, to extend this conversation out into the audience as well, and to hear from you about what those barriers and what those challenges are. And I think that, you know, you would be the foremost experts on your region and be able to provide us with those insights as well. So I welcome the opportunity for others to share their perspectives. Yes, let's move to you. You. Anj, here in the front. Yeah.
Hi, I am Mariam Wanaim from Morocco. And actually, I want to share an experience that I had. I don't know if you know about Imagine Cup. It's a program that is launched by Microsoft, and within that program, with my team, we developed a platform that we called Smart Vaccination. Actually, it was supposed to notify the parents about the vaccination meetings of their children, and to make some kind of smart calendar so that they can track vaccinations. One of the issues that we found in really implementing this in Morocco is, one, the infrastructure. Morocco, we have some regions that are in the mountains. It was a little bit challenging to make the whole technology infrastructure, even though we implemented a voice messaging system. We still had a problem with the centralization of data. For example, we need the medical records to be moving with the user. So for example, if he goes from a city to a city, we need that record to travel with him, not only to stay in that little town. So that was one of the first challenges. The second one was more of a cultural challenge. Like we ran a little survey, and we found out that parents in some regions are not very open to this idea of having some kind of power. That's how they label it, like some authority telling them what to do with the health of their children, like if they are not really taking care of their children, or like if the old method was not working well. So I'm really look forward for you, especially Alex, to share with me your experience on the cultural side first. And if ever you encountered technological aspects issues, How did you, for example, how did you manage to get computers in the region? Did you find any funders for this or governments? Thank you.
Thank you. Sure, if you want. Yeah, we could take a couple more. Any other comments and or questions? Yes, Maya, and then we'll come over. So here first, and then we'll come to you.
Thank you. I am Farida Mansouri from Tunisia. I am a tech woman. I am the head of department in Ministry of Agriculture, so I will ask about farmers. I am working in the organic farming, so I think that I want to ask a question. If there is any possibility to have a pilot zone in Tunisia and practice what you are doing in other countries. We try to help our organic farmer to have a market in Tunisia and outside. So I want to know if there is any possibility to do that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And we have another question from the lady who just took a picture.
So, Patty, I just wanted to tell you about something that might be helpful to you. If you're looking for technology that tracks positive health behaviors, there's a device called a Fitbit. I don't know you've got one. Okay. Well, I mean, it's actually pretty nice. They've got it's got a good way of tracking things. It seems to be relatively bulletproof. It encourages good behaviors all around, and it's incredibly easy to use. So as a way of encouraging exercise and proper diet, which are next to sanitation, probably some of those things that people need to do most, it's a good start.
Okay, and then one last one, and then we'll respond if there are any responses. Yes, ma'am.
Hi. Hello. Hi. I just have a question. I'm one of the Tech Women mentors. My name is Rekha. And the question I have is a couple, actually. If we, as part of the engineering community, I also work with a nonprofit called Design Revolution. They build product innovation designs to make it affordable. And the question is, you have a really great think tank. You have experiences of taking products and technologies to all these far off places and really understand what it means to deliver these technologies. So if there are engineering communities that needed to work with you, what are the different models that you would work with? And the second question is, are there any win-wins with any, you know, like telecoms or enterprises that you look for? What kind of win-wins have really worked, you know, for the nonprofit side? That would be.
Okay, and let's do on just one last one, and then we're having to wrap up soon. So let's, yes, ma'am, in the red jacket, please. Or pink, or I think that's.
Thank you. My name is Rodaisa.
Just keep.
Yep.
My name is Rodaisa.
And I'm from Jordan. Actually, I'm Palestinian from Jordan, and I just want to just give you an idea. I was raised in a camp, so I was one of the poor people we're talking about, and I want to give you like an idea. Now, I knew all my life that there was help coming from outside. Now, the issue is that we did not see a lot of these. We had, but I think that, I don't know exactly, do you work with the government or with NGOs to find these poor people? Till now, I'm still like working with a lot of NGOs to go to these people, and I feel that they're still skeptical, let's say, about any help coming from outside. Mm-hmm. They think that there's like, you know, the conspiracy theory, that the idea of people, you know, when you're poor, you're not convinced that there are people helping without an agenda. Mm. Yeah, so they are either they want something from us, or they want to be like being like shown as they're good on account of us, or they are taking like 90% of the money and they are giving us like 10%. So I'm not sure. I think that you might be. You need. I don't know if you're like working with the locals to reach these people, and working with one of them. Don't go to the people who's educated, rich, and with a good intent, because as though they are good, they have good intention, but they don't know exactly what these people need. Mm-hmm. So you need one of them to convince them that your intention are good. Thank you.
All right, great. So that is a lot for this panel to chew on. And you know, for the final 5 minutes that we have before we break into refreshments, I'm just going to, I think, take us down the line and allow you to address whichever of any or all of the questions and comments that have been made to your choosing, and if you have any kind of final remark that you would like to make. So this time, let's start with Alex, and we'll move down to Adarsh.
Sure. A lot of great questions. You know, when I started working in the Middle East, North Africa, people said, this is the land of conspiracy theories. And I said, listen, I've been working for 6 years in Bangladesh. And nothing will equate to that experience. And I think that the truth of the matter is that first of all, having a local partner with us, it's the Abdul Latif Jamil Group, who really understood the lay of the land that would take us 25 years, was important. And the other thing is just, if you deliver value, I think the conspiracy theories for most of the people tend to dissolve. A couple of things quickly, in terms of just the ecosystem, if I understood your question right, you know, to make these things work is ever-changing, complex. It's not one simple entity, whether it's a funder or not. But we do feel that having a large scaling partner, co-creating from the beginning, is very important. We're a $25 million organization. We're not huge. But by partnering with groups that are much, much bigger, it's a headache. Some of them tend to be a little bureaucratic, no names. But they can actually, if they feel an ownership, they can get something to scale in a way that we can't. In terms of, if I understood your question, of a win-win type of, when we worked with MTN in Uganda, just I reminded in the early days, they didn't extend their network out to a lot of Uganda. And so we made an investment in these kind of booster cables, booster antennas, that a cell phone could work outside of their network. And it actually it cut those business people, micro entrepreneurs, in on the early cell revolution, made them kind of cutting edge technologists in their community, and it demonstrated to MTN that there was a market out there that they could make money on that they didn't know before, and it also was a good revenue source for us. So that's just one that comes to mind. The community knowledge worker in Tunisia, I'd be happy to talk to you about it. And also put you in touch with our team in Dubai that does that. And just the last two things, we do have a program, speaking of mentors, and called Bankers Without Borders, but that is way beyond financial services. We have a 10,000 person reserve corps of technologists and financial sector people and management consultants. We partner up for ways to work with poverty fighting organizations, and so you can check that out. And just last, you know, I think the question was here about, is this replacing the drug therapy or whatever? And the way I think of it is that, it was kind of, you said this, is that is well-designed applications can really be an accelerator for, not a replacement for, drug therapies and also frontline staff, whether they're agricultural extensionists or health workers. They can be an enabler of them rather than a replacement of them. And that's one thing we've had to underline in Uganda. We're not trying to put the agricultural extension service out of business. We're trying to create a tool that can allow them to get more done and to manage information more efficiently than they've been able to do up till now.
Great. I think a couple of points that I wanted to pick up on. One is the need for design and design thinking in a lot of this work. So I find myself, you know, engaged in fora, you know, at the country level, at the global level, thinking to myself, what we really need is a designer to come in and help facilitate some of these discussions and facilitate processes across multiple stakeholders to identify, you know, going back to some of these win-wins that can really benefit multiple people together. But I think it's the need is much more around the processes than it is around the the particular technology. And what you'll find when you start to engage in some of these processes and discussions is that a lot of the technologies already exist. They're just not being systematically applied to address the types of problems that they could be addressed to apply. And then the work that needs to happen to bring meaning into them is probably this much, instead of sort of starting from scratch and trying to build something from the ground up. And then just in terms of looking at people at the bottom of the pyramid and really engaging them, I think we work on a program called MAMA, which is the Mobile Alliance for Maternal Action. And one of the challenges that we're facing is the desire to be sustainable while trying to reach those who need the services the most. And so even as late as a week ago, you know, we were sitting with the major donors for this program to clearly decide, are we committed to reaching those who need to be reached, or do we want to make sure that this program lasts longer? And they came down on the side of meeting the needs of those that need the information most. And we do a lot of work with local partners, et cetera, but it is that challenge where, you know, you're trying to look for economies of scale, you're trying to look to see where are some of the emerging business models that are going to make this, you know, these efforts sustainable over time. And we're learning a lot as we go along. So, you know, it's a time right now of great learning. And in the next few years, what we're, you know, and we're starting to see more and more are these very large scale national efforts to deploy mobile technology in a systematic way with all the sort of support systems in place to manage them.
Going back to the last question around how do we kind of engage the people who are local, maybe at the bottom of the pyramid and so on. And that's precisely what we are trying to do. It's not an easy thing to do because technology, even if you give somebody a cell phone, doesn't mean he or she is going to participate. So a lot of things need to happen before the technology can actually start its kind of its work, so to speak, right? So building trust is a key component. Building, like, it's also a lot to do with human behavioral change and change management, as Alex was referring to. You know, I was met with somebody who does a lot of work around sanitation, and he said there are many, many examples where we build a lot of toilets, but nobody uses it. Because it's not about the toilet that, you know, people have this notion that you build a toilet, people will start using it. That's not the case. It's about changing the behavior. Humans are used to certain behavior and certain patterns, and it's not that easy to change. Same applies for technology interventions as well. But the intention is, because of the cell phone penetration, we have the unique opportunity to listen to the ultimate end user, ultimate beneficiary, if you will, and bring them early on. So not only at just the service level, whether you received water or food, etc., but early on into the policymaking process. But that's a multi-way conversation, right? It's not only about the people at the government. You know, you need other, you know, media needs to be play its part. The civil societies, they need to play it part. The other nonprofits and other foundations need to play it part. So a lot of these things. Obviously, today's event, we focused a lot on technology, but it's the non-tech part that consumes most of the time when the technology actually kicks in. Going back to there's a question around win-win, around how do you leverage, like, that's another area we focus on. Like, typically in the old days, like, World Bank used to talk to, you know, the policy guys or the economists and so on. Like, we didn't talk to the software guys. Like, there, you know, there are a few people like me in the bank and growing, but it's not like, you know, I'm not the typical World Bank guy. So what one thing we're trying to do is to say, how can we engage the local technology community so they can participate in the local change management process? One thing we realized that, you know, the software developers, as somebody said, they all speak Java, right? So they are connected ubiquitously through the software language, right? So that's easy. The other thing is, oftentimes, when I was into software development myself many years ago, I knew how to develop, but I didn't know the problem. I didn't understand the context. So you have to bridge that gap. So a lot of exciting, you know, young people like yourself, I want to contribute to the society, but they say, I have the skills, but I don't know how to use it. So the question is then, how do you bring the, so my example of water hackathon is to bring these different groups together and give them defined problems to solve. Then they can use the skills to do it. And obviously also focusing, we're trying to emphasize more on the design thinking principles, like think about the actual end users. As I said, in the old days, we used to, you know, work with the governments and we often used to talk to them, but now the question is, how do we know that all the work, all the aid, all the lending that we do is actually making impact on the ground, and therefore, how do we listen better to the citizens? So, thanks.
Yeah, thank you. I think, you know, I love that this event, this portion of the event is wrapping up around a conversation about engaging communities on the ground, understanding the end user, understanding those who were building these technologies for, providing new interventions and access to. And I think in the work that we've done on asset building and financial services, we've learned a lot about the need to listen to the voices of those who we are creating interventions for. And finding ways to do that more and better in these challenging environments in which, you know, we do have barriers in terms of resources that enable us to do that and so on. And I hope and believe that technology is also going to be a great connector, an increasing connector that's going to allow us greater access faster to those voices, the ability to hear them more clearly, to understand them better. And I think that that is kind of the, at the core of a lot of the proposals that we make, both within the Global Assets Project, but also within a number of the initiatives, the Open Technology Institute here at the New America Foundation. So I think it's a great place for us to perhaps wrap it up. I see a burning question, but we are over time. It's 30, less than 30 seconds? Yes. Okay, go ahead.
Idea, I don't know if you have this experience, is to launch online classes for children in high mountains or with limited mobility in one of emerging countries. Thank you.
Great. Well, I won't go into all of that right now, but I will say it's a great idea. I love that, you know, we're still sparking ideas and more questions. We do have some refreshments outside for everyone and a good half an hour or more of time for us to stay together, continue to share and continue this conversation. So I'd love to thank our panelists for joining us today and sharing their insights. To the 41 Tech Women and all of their mentors, the State Department, OTI, everyone who brought the event together. It was very lively, informative. I am looking forward to this conversation continuing out in the hall and going forward. And I just want to say, quickly coming back to what I mentioned at the beginning of the event, that on Thursday it is the International Day of the Girl, and that's on our heels. And I think that that's an important reminder to us of the opportunities ahead, but the challenges that still exist to empowering girls. So I'd like to just leave you all with that challenge to think about and to continue to think about the work that you're doing, what you've learned through this experience with Tech Women, and how it could impact the next generation as you go back to your respective countries, and what that's going to mean for the next generation of women leaders such as yourself. So thank you. Please enjoy your refreshments right outside the door, and we'll all be around to continue the conversation. Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure.